Now on KCRA 3.
Two tragedies unfolding right now. Fire emergency in Northern California.
Just goes to show how dangerous this fire is.
Widespread destruction in Butte County. The evacuations underway.
It is hurting people, and we want people to get out of the way.
And the conditions fueling the fire.
And in Southern California,
we got multiple people down. We need a lot of ambulance.
A shooting rampage in Thousand Oaks kills 12.
Let me be clear, we do need blood donations.
We're live with the outpouring of support and the heartbreak of a community.
As I told his wife, he died a hero. He went in to save lives, to save other people.
This is KCRA 3. We begin with breaking news.
And we begin with the breaking news in Butte County. That fire emergency, a dangerous situation right now. Fast-moving flames tearing through the area, forcing tens of thousands of people to leave their homes in a panicked rush to escape.
So here's a closer look at where this fire is burning. It started around 7 this morning near the town of Polga off Highway 70. And at first report, it was 10 acres in size. But within an hour, the winds had pushed that to 2,000 acres. By noon, 5,000. And now it's ballooned to 18,000 acres.
Let's go to Live Copter 3, a view you'll see only on KCRA 3. And this is what it looks like on the ground. Flames tearing through the trees. They're up the hillside in this very rugged terrain of Butte County near Paradise, near Magalia, and you can see that very clear fire line.
Yeah, already you can see there is a getting ready for dusk this time of evening. There we've got one of the planes there getting ready to make a retardant drop, or it just finished one, but it looks like it's kind of circling back around to make one right now. But yeah, Lisa, you can see all the thick smoke out there. Look at the flying conditions, trying to pilot that plane through all that smoke right now and get to the location where they're trying to make this drop. In fact, we're about to lose sight of that plane. That's how thick the smoke is right now. But it is just an incredible sight to see this Butte County wildfire right now, and that the winds have just whipped up. Look at all the smoke, and there again, more of the flames kind of racing up that hillside there, and you can see there's just a lot of dry fuel in its path.
So here's another perspective of the situation that people were facing as they had just moments to get out. This video sent to us by Forrest Glenn, and you can see how close the flames were to the road as people were driving through basically a wall of orange on either side, embers falling all over on either side of that roadway. And you saw how backed up the cars were. That has really been a problem with the evacuation today.
Yeah, we also know homes and buildings have been destroyed by this fire. At least 5 people have been burned.
We've got live team coverage for you. Chief Meteorologist Mark Finan tracking the winds and the fire conditions, and an entire team of reporters working in Butte County right now. Let's begin with KCRA 3's Max Resnick, who's been out there all day long and very close to where the fire is burning. In fact, I think we can see the flames behind you.
Yeah, Lisa, Brian, good afternoon. These flames just crept up here just behind us within the last few minutes. We've been waiting for this because these winds have been pushing in this direction. This is a fire pushing southwest. We're on the left flank of this fire, and you can see the strength of this and how quickly it's just engulfing this area. This is very dry brush here. This is the perfect recipe for a fast and quick moving wildfire. Here in Butte County, it has been quite an effort by the firefighters here on the ground. But as you see, and as has been the case throughout the day, it's all about the wind. The campfire burns and spreads on this hillside near Paradise Airport as a helicopter makes drop after drop along Highway 191 in Butte County. The fire goes where the wind tells it, and those winds are erratic, often changing direction and speed.
I can see the fire coming over the ridge. That tells me it's time to get out.
First responders drive north on 191 as dozens of evacuees head south.
When I get down here, everything's on fire. Even our ranch is on fire. My house is on fire. Everything. So as far as I know right now, you cannot get up to Paradise. Everybody's trying to get out, and it's just bad.
Fire Captain John Gaddy says this is a dangerous fire with many people injured and many buildings destroyed.
It is hurting people, and we want people to get out of the way. That is our main job right now, is protecting life. If we can protect property, if possible, we'll do it. But right now, it's just protecting life and getting them out of the way of this.
Firefighters work to get the upper hand while pleading with people to get out.
We're asking anyone who is under evacuation warnings to heed those warnings, get out now, follow the directions of the Butte County Sheriff.
How good this road is.
And you can see once again live pictures of this fire just about a few hundred feet behind us. You can feel the heat. You can see the wind pushing our way. We have a bulldozer in place right over here. That's on standby. Caltrans is here as well. We also have a fire crew just up the road here on 191. Would imagine that they're going to get after this here pretty soon as this consumes this area. We're going to move to a safer location. We'll bring you an update as soon as possible. Reporting live in Butte County, Max Resnick, KCRA 3 News.
Yes, we agree. You need to move right now. You're way too close to that. And we just saw, Max, thank you so much. We don't need your live picture anymore. You guys need to get out of there. But Mark, we just saw how fast those flames move from the time Max Resnick started talking. A minute and a half later, those flames were right behind him.
And that's just one flank of the fire. So the fire is burning in multiple locations. Let's go back to about 6:30 this morning, 6:30, 7 o'clock, when this fire broke out. It wasn't all that big to begin with. It was up near Pulga. It got the name because it started on Camp Creek Road. It's called the Campfire, but it started on Camp Creek Road. That's how it got the name. Now, this is the wind that we had in the early morning hours, that strong downslope wind going right down the Feather River Canyon. And now the fire started pretty small near Highway 70, but within just a few hours, it leapt through the Concow Reservoir area and then up the hill into Paradise. That covered that distance of about 6 miles in only about 3 hours. This thing really raced for a fire. And now it continues to spread north toward Magalia and Paradise Pines, and then farther to the south. Down here is where Max was, but we're seeing Live Copter 3 show these areas up around here. It is continues to burn down this canyon. We do expect that this is going to continue to be very active throughout the next few hours because the winds here are continuing to gust well up over 20 miles an hour. And it's not just the area in the immediate fire that's being impacted. A huge amount of smoke coming off of this fire. This is a photo from about an hour ago, and look at how the smoke is spreading, especially thick into Napa County and Lake County. You're getting smoke in Marysville and Sacramento, but boy, it is really thick once you go to the North Bay counties, especially in Lake County right now, a really thick layer of smoke from this very big fire burning in Butte County. Back to you.
Yeah, that's great perspective, Mark. Thank you. And here is another video sent to us by a KCRA3 viewer, Jan Sweeney. Jan in the car trying to get out of Paradise. You can see again the bright flames very close to the road there, and it appears there's some type of structure burning there as well. Now, thousands of people who live in the area have been evacuated, more than 25,000 just in Paradise.
An all-day emergency crews pleading for people to get out and put their own safety ahead of their property. KCRA3's Marley Martinez joins us with a look at the evacuations that have been underway all day. Marley.
It's eerie. It's apocalyptic. That's what people keep saying when they describe the scene around me. Hard to believe that it's 4 in the afternoon because you can see the sky. The smoke here is blocking out any sunlight here near Paradise. This road here, it's practically empty except for emergency crews, ambulance, firefighters that have been making their way towards Paradise. But that wasn't the case just 2 hours ago. 2 hours ago, there were thousands of people escaping the area, trying to make their way out of Paradise. And coming up, we will show you what it looked like as we were making our way in. Houses on fire, vehicles charred and abandoned. Flames dot the landscape of Paradise. A caravan of ambulances, firefighters, and other emergency crews make their way in as people from the area are stuck outside.
Where you see the beginning of the smoke, that's where they're at.
Ryan Wilson lives in Magalia with his wife, 2.5-year-old, and 1-month-old.
There's no way to get a hold of anybody up there. All the lines are down. People are jumping the curbs. It's chaotic out here.
He was at work at the time the fire ignited, but his family was at home.
I told her not to go because Skyway was on fire. I wish I told her never to stop, just not go. She could have probably made it through. But no, she's at home with 2 kids by herself. Was waiting for me to come home and help. Can't do anything.
People desperately leaving Paradise while others are trying to get in. Now, thankfully, we can report that Brian's family is okay. Just a couple hours ago, we were standing there with him when he got a call from his wife. They were able to escape the area, and they are now at an area evacuation center. Now, as far as people in the area, we do have some people who are staying close by. They are waiting to see what happened to their homes. We'll bring you their stories a little bit later. Back to you guys in the studio. Mm-hmm.
so thankful that his family's okay. I know we've been wondering that all day. Marley, thank you for the updates. And really, she gave us a good idea of what they've been dealing with. The evacuations created a huge traffic jam along the way.
KCRA3's Mike Lurie has been talking with some of the evacuees. He's live in Chico now with the latest there. Mike?
And Brian, let me set the scene for you here in Chico, where you can see an orange sky behind me, almost very eerie and surrealistic. But as I walk over this way, you can see the skies are very black, not from rain, but from smoke caused by that fire, the campfire, which has caused thousands of people to leave Paradise and come down here to Chico. And the skies, the roads have been so filled with traffic that many people are here at the CVS Pharmacy parking lot, many of them not sure where to go. Sounds of sirens filled the air as thousands of people jammed Highway 99 in Butte County as they fled from the fast-moving campfire.
Where are you evacuating from?
We're from Paradise. It took us 3.5 hours to get down the hill between the fire and the black smoke and ashes.
How bad is it up there?
Worse than 2008.
The skies were filled with ash and with smoke so thick that day turned into night. All this as evacuees fled a town ironically called Paradise for a scene that looked like hell on earth, with the sun literally blotted out by angry smoke clouds.
It was quick. All I seen is flames. It got dark. Our neighbor came, knocked on the door, said, I think we might need to evacuate.
Christopher Molis did evacuate, taking his two dogs and five birds with him, leaving his home behind. And like so many here, not knowing where to go.
How bad is it up there?
It's like nighttime. It's pitch black.
You have your whole family with you?
Got everybody with us.
Stay safe.
We will.
And back here live, where there are literally dozens of evacuees here, they tell us that they feel safe for now, but they really want to know what's happened to their homes. We'll have more on that coming up tonight at 5. Reporting live in Chico, Mike Lurie, KCRA 3 News.
All right, Mike, thank you.
Wow, just some incredible sound there that he got with people who were getting out. All right, so we're going to continue to follow the breaking news on air and online of the fire in Butte County. And be sure to download our KCRA3 app now for the latest on the acreage, the containment numbers, and any evacuation orders.
All right, the other breaking news we're following in Southern California, where we're learning more about a deadly mass shooting. 12 people killed, including a sheriff's deputy, after a gunman opened fire inside a crowded nightclub before taking his own life. Witnesses describing the horror they saw.
Just trying to get out, get behind a car, get behind something, and then
we just tried to take cover.
We couldn't get out because the shooting was on that side. So then our friends got the bar stools and they started slamming it against the window so we could get out.
So the nightmare of a situation. Now, one of the first people through the door to help was Sergeant Ron Hillis, who was killed. Authorities say he exchanged gunfire with the suspect and was hit multiple times before another officer dragged him away. Mourners, as you see here, lined the streets earlier today to honor the 29-year veteran of the department as his body was driven from the hospital to the coroner's office. He is being called a hero.
He had every intention of going in there and ending that threat and saving lives. Unfortunately, he was just met immediately with gunfire, and it's just a tragic loss for all of us, for the community.
And he was getting ready to retire in the next year. He leaves behind a wife and a son. And we're also slowly beginning to learn more about the other victims of this shooting.
22-year-old Cody Kaufman being mourned by many. His father is devastated. Jason Kaufman says he told his son last night not to drink and drive, and says the last thing he said to Cody was, I love you.
My firstborn son. Only him and I know how much I love, how much I miss. Oh, God, this is so hard. Oh, son, I love you so much. Oh, Heavenly Father, just please be with him.
It's painful to watch.
It is. And also identified by family, 18-year-old Elena Housley. She was a student at Pepperdine University. She is the niece of actress Tamara Mowry Housley and former Fox News correspondent Adam Housley. They describe her as an incredible young woman whose life was cut short. Just a horrible situation. And of course, there is an outpouring of support in Ventura County for the victims, for the survivors, and for their families.
KCRA3's Vicky Gonzalez is live now at California Lutheran University. It's one of several locations still coming together. Vicky.
Brian and Lisa, Borderline Bar and Grill is just a 10 to 15 minute drive from this university, a popular spot for students. Some of those classmates were inside that bar last night. Inside the chapel, people are praying, they are talking, and they are writing messages. This is just one example of a community, a tight-knit one, going above and beyond. Earlier today, we were at a blood drive, overwhelming the community of Thousand Oaks in the best way possible. Several hundred people spending hours in line to give. Compassion traveling down the street and around the block to donate blood. From strangers, college students, and parents, the trajectory of their day taking an uplifting course following horrific, deadly hate.
I right away just texted my friends who were there. One of them got back to me right away saying they're hiding in a bathroom stall. And some of them were just, they're still like, it's really loud, I don't know what's happening. I was texting her while the gunshots were being fired, and it was just like a shocking, and just kind of go numb after hearing that.
From food to drinks, affection, donations you can taste and feel. For everyone, this was an opportunity to rise above lives senselessly ripped away. It truly was an incredible moment during the darkest time. There were so many people, too much, that they had to turn some people away, asking them to return tomorrow again at 10 a.m. to donate blood. Live in Thousand Oaks, Vicky Gonzalez, KCRA 3 News.
All right, Vicky, certainly a lot of people trying to do whatever they can to help right now. We're also learning more about the killer. He's been identified as 28-year-old Ian David Long. He was a former U.S. Marine who served one combat tour in Afghanistan that lasted for 7 months from 2010 to 2011. He was a machine gunner, and he earned the rank of corporal in 2011. Authorities say he was armed with a handgun.
The weapon used in this horrific shooting was a Glock 21 45 caliber handgun. The handgun is designed to hold, in California, 10 rounds and one in the chamber. This weapon did have an extended magazine on it.
At this point, we do not have any indicators of other associates, or there are no other threats to the Los Angeles area.
Investigators say they responded to a call for someone in distress at Long's home back in April. They found him to be irate and irrational. They say a mental health professional determined at the time, though, that he did not qualify for a psychiatric hold. We will have more on the California bar massacre coming up on the KCRA 3 News at 5, also on the NBC Nightly News at 5:30. Lester Holt will anchor coverage from the scene, and he will have up-to-the-minute details on the shooting, the investigation, the gunman, and the victims.
We also have much more still ahead here on the KCRA 3 News at 4, including the captain in a deadly duck boat accident indicted.
And here's another live look at the wildfire burning in Butte County. So far, 18,000 acres on fire, property lost. You can see all the thick black smoke out there, as it's only going to get darker here in about an hour. Mark Finan coming up with another update on the conditions and the winds out there right after this.
We continue to follow breaking news out of Butte County, where fast-moving wildfire has taken more than 18,000 acres today, and viewers have been sending us video, cell phone video like this, of the fire and the smoke. Ryan Atchison sent us this video as he drove along a road between Chico and Durham.
Yeah, you can see that smoke, how thick and heavy it is. It's just sitting right down on the ground there. And we want to show you this, another live look from Live Copter 3 right now, as the fire is 18,000 acres. And Live Copter is flying right just north of Magalia right now. And this is where the fire is burning. This is a pretty highly dense area of trees. And I mean, that's just all you can see right now in the picture, is trees, flames, and smoke. And there you can see some of the flames shooting pretty high into the air as it gets up into those trees and just tears right through them.
All right, we're going to check back in with Chief Meteorologist Mark Finan in just a moment. But first, we want to update you on some other news this afternoon. An elementary school in Stockton reopened today after a lockdown yesterday when some students became sick. This happened at Hong Kingston Elementary, and some students reported feeling lightheaded and passed out. The school was placed on a soft lockdown to give first responders easy access to those students. Four were taken to the hospital. The cause of the sickness has not yet been determined, which has some parents on edge, as you can imagine, and some of them kept their kids out of school today.
They couldn't give us a valid answer of what happened to our children. And I just feel like the school should not be open the very next day if you do not know what's going on inside of these walls, inside of the school.
School district says it is investigating to make sure that the school is a safe place for students and employees. And the school says the cafeteria, kitchen, campus food, and the air were tested and it was all cleared. So that investigation is still ongoing.
And let's get to KCRA 3 weather now. And Chief Meteorologist Mark Finan. Mark, you told us yesterday that these winds were something we needed to be ready for.
And it's one thing to have wind, but when we always talk about it, when we are going to get winds like this, that a small fire can become a big fire in a hurry. And we've seen a classic example of that today. Let's go back to Livecopter 3. So just for some perspective, Livecopter is showing us pictures here on the northern edge of the fire. So this is up north of Magalia. So what you see here are it's hilly and wooded terrain. Earlier in the newscast, you saw Max Resnick. He was on the south side of the fire, miles away to the south of this. In between, there's Magalia, there's Paradise Pines, and Livecopter and Max Resnick can't get in there because the smoke is so thick, because that area has been evacuated. We can't get a look at what's happening in the populated area around Paradise right now. We'd love to be able to show you. We want to know what's going on in there too. But we just can't get in there right now because it is still a very active fire area in Paradise and in Magalia right now. In Sacramento, we do have some smoke in the area. It's 71 degrees. Wind still northwesterly at 18 and very dry air. Look at that dew point, 18 degrees. Very, very dry air. That contributes to the higher fire danger on a day like this. Stockton also has a little bit of smoke in 73 degrees. In Modesto, we have sunshine. It is 70 degrees. Another mild day for this time of year. Fairfield's gotten some smoke. We have 70 degrees. Winds out of the north at 18. And in South Lake Tahoe, we don't have smoke. Instead, we have sunshine, but it's only 42 degrees, and it's even relatively breezy around South Lake Tahoe. We'll get back to some of those pictures from the fire in just a little bit. So here's the wind we have right now. It's that classic north wind, 18 miles an hour in Sacramento, 20 miles an hour in Marysville. But let me show you some of the top gusts that we had today. I know you've never heard of Jarbo Gap. It's in the Feather River Canyon, not too far from where the fire started. But back around 3 o'clock this morning, we had a wind gust of 52 miles an hour. Down on the valley floor, we saw a lot of areas have wind gusts up over 30, like Vacaville at 35 and Sacramento 31. But as we go through the night tonight, the winds will gradually back off. And then this is tomorrow morning at 7:30. Notice most of the winds are under 10 miles an hour. We are still seeing some breezes, especially in Butte County, but the trend tomorrow is going to be to have the winds calm down. This is 5 o'clock tomorrow. The winds are 5 miles an hour or less. So we'll lose the wind during the day tomorrow, but still the next 4 or 5 hours, there's going to be enough wind in the fire zone to make that fire continue to be quite active. Tomorrow, Truckee goes to 56 after starting off at 18. The foothills will have lighter winds and a lot of sunshine tomorrow with afternoon temperatures in the upper 60s to near 70, but a cold morning. Fairfield tomorrow goes to 73 degrees. For the valley, our early morning temperatures will be down in the 40s, a cool morning, but by the afternoon, Manteca will warm to 72. And for Sacramento, 73 with lighter winds than what we've been seeing today. As we head into the weekend, sunshine of highs around 70 and cool mornings. Maybe a couple of clouds on Monday and Tuesday, but that the rest of next week will be dry. A lot of Veterans Day observance is coming up on Sunday. That day will be just fine.
Okay, Mark, thanks. Okay. We'll be right back after this.
New option for asthma sufferers, a new over-the-counter medication will soon be available. The FDA has approved a new version of Primatene Mist to treat mild intermittent cases of asthma. It's the only over-the-counter metered dose inhaler. A previous version was taken off the market back in 2011 because it contained chlorofluorocarbon propellants, which are harmful to the environment. The mist will be in stores early next year.
Fewer Americans are smoking cigarettes. That's according to an annual survey by the Centers for Disease Control. It shows about 14% of American adults used cigarettes last year. That's the lowest level ever recorded. There was also a decrease among younger adults. 10% of those between the ages of 18 and 24 smoked cigarettes. That's down from 13% a year earlier. However, nearly 47 million adults have used some form of tobacco, including e-cigarettes or hookahs. Still to come here in the next half hour, the captain of a duck boat in Missouri indicted after that deadly crash last summer. Also, more live coverage from Southern California in the aftermath of last night's mass shooting.
And we continue to follow breaking news, and we'll go back north to the fire lines in Butte County. Live aerial pictures over the fire from Live Copter 3 as this very destructive fire that has already injured some people and forced the evacuation of thousands continues to burn. We'll be right back.
KCRA 3, this is breaking news.
We continue to follow breaking news out of Butte County as we look at these live pictures from Live Copter 3, fast-moving wildfire, and we have just learned that two firefighters have been injured battling this fire. Now, this fire is called the Camp Fire because it started on Camp Creek Road. And we don't know which agency those two firefighters that were injured are from. There are several agencies helping out in this firefight today. This fire began about 9 hours ago, about 6:49 this morning, exploding quickly. And now it's grown to more than 18,000 acres burning through the town of Paradise, forcing an estimated 30,000 people from their homes early this morning. And right now, this fire continues to spread with no containment at all in sight. Right now, they're just trying to get people out of there and keep people safe.
And we do know that some other people, at least five other people, have been hurt. Two of them are at UC Davis Medical Center right now. Let's check in with Max Resnick. He's been on the front lines of this fire since earlier today, and he has actually had to move his location since several times because of those advancing flames. Max, you're in a different spot from last time we saw you.
Yeah, Brian, good afternoon. We moved about 1,000 feet, maybe a quarter mile from where we were. And if you just look over my right shoulder here into those disappearing power poles there, that's where we were. And the fire burned right up to that line. We were with Cal Fire. And in fact, in the distance here, maybe a little bit to the left there. Yeah, you see that? You see a fire truck or some emergency lights coming towards us. And just behind that, you can see some of the flames. The wind here in some instances has been gusty. And then right now it's fairly calm. So we're getting these really variable winds right now, and that is the thing that Cal Fire and firefighters have been talking about all day, is the erratic nature of the fire that we're dealing with right now and the erratic nature of these winds. That's really kind of controlling the fire at this point, and it is presenting for them the biggest obstacle. And you couple that with the fact, and you look right behind me, look how dry this is. I mean, this is the perfect ripe conditions for a fast moving and fast spreading wildfire. And in the case that we saw over there, just a kind of a smaller grass fire, but certainly a very dynamic situation, a very fluid situation as well, and one that firefighters are keeping a close eye on.
Yeah, Max, and just when you had the camera pushed in a little bit tighter, we could barely even make out those fire trucks in the distance because the smoke is that thick. All right, Max, thank you.
Yeah, it's extremely thick. You can't escape it. In fact, we saw about 12 trucks that were just lined up right here waiting to go up that road. So they're in and out. Emergency personnel keeps moving up and down Highway 191, trying to get up the hill and attack this fire, and then likely moving down, refueling, and then just heading right back up.
So, Max, I'm just noticing things like on the ground seem to be pretty calm behind you. Have the winds where you are calmed down at all from where we were, let's say, at noon?
From where we were at noon, it's really tough to say, because at certain points we felt the winds that were very gusty, and we felt them from a certain direction, and then they would calm down, then they would pick up again and move in a different direction. At this moment, they feel calm, but as we've seen, in 5 minutes, that can change.
All right, Max Resnick reporting live for us. Again, he's been at the scene all day long. Max, please be safe. Thank you so much.
And we have Chief Meteorologist Mark Fine, and he's been, of course, watching things since late this morning. You knew that these winds were going to come.
Well, and as Max was talking about, the winds continue to be quite variable. Let me first start on the wider view here, and you can see that general north flow. Once you go south of Interstate 80, the winds are pretty light, and same thing in the foothills south of Highway 50. But the farther north you go, here's where we have seen the teeth of the wind. Now, this is the current wind. wind. And look at how variable it is in this short area. Chico currently has a 25 mile an hour sustained wind that's gusting up over 30. That's going right down Highway 70. Paradise isn't reporting right now. But then Jarbo Gap has a wind of just 8 miles an hour, still gusting into the mid 20s. But you have the wind that comes down the Feather River Canyon this way, and you can follow the streamlines through Butte County this way. So you get into this mountainous terrain where there are canyons on both sides of Paradise. You can get very variable wind directions and speeds that can change from minute to minute. Back to you.
All right, Mark, thank you. And the other big story that we continue to follow today is the community of Thousand Oaks in Southern California. Just devastation, shock, and mourning all across the community. A gunman opened fire early this morning inside a crowded bar and killed 12 people.
We have team coverage for you. In addition to Vicky Gonzalez, we also have KCRA3's Emily Maha standing by in Southern California. But we want to begin with NBC's Jay Gray reporting for us tonight. And he's live outside the Borderline Bar and Grill in Thousand Oaks. And just a terrible situation there, Jay.
Yeah, Lisa, Brian, good to talk to you. Horrible conditions, though. You're absolutely right. We are just outside the Borderline Bar and Grill, which is directly behind us here. This area locked down. This community, obviously, still stunned and grieving at this point. Investigators combing this bar and grill for any evidence they may find, anything that could help lead them to how and why all of this happened. This was a weekly occurrence here, the country music night for college-age kids. It was something that so many of them said was a routine for them, and it felt like a safe place, and that's using their words. There were more than 100 people inside at the time of the attack. It happened just after 11 o'clock last night. A lone gunman walking in, armed with a pistol and an extended clip, and opened fire, killing people who worked at the bar, and then turning toward the dance floor where students had been line dancing just moments earlier and began firing. Several dozen rounds, according to police, fired before a sheriff's deputy as well as tactical officers moved in, and the gunman apparently, Ryan and Lisa, turning his weapon on himself.
And speaking of the gunman, what do we know, Jay, about the suspect?
Ian Long, a 28-year-old ex-Marine who had spent some time in Afghanistan. Police were called to his residence in April after neighbors and family members had said he was acting erratically. Mental health experts reviewed him at the time, interviewed him, and said that they didn't believe he posed a threat to himself or others. Really no other major scrapes with the law, a few traffic tickets and things like that. There are some who were inside the bar last night who said that they may have seen him there once or twice, but certainly he wasn't a regular there. There's also been some talk from those who know him and family members that he had been threatening to his mother and that she was actually concerned about what he may do and that he may have been dealing with some PTSD. Again, this is all still very early in an investigation that's going to be very intense and go on for quite some time.
Yeah, Jay, we know the investigators will figure that stuff out in due time, but right now it's all about these victims and these families for sure. Thanks, Jay. We're also hearing a lot more about people who were inside that bar when the shooting took place.
Just take a listen to some of their harrowing accounts.
He heard, I knew it was bullets, I knew it was shots fired. A lot of the young people, they thought it was not real, and I just pulled him down and started yelling, get down, get down. And the shooter shot the doorman.
We dropped and we heard the gunshots. A lot of gunshots. And I was just laying there, kind of not. Everyone was under the table, so it was hard to kind of get under there, but I was with my friends. And I look behind me, and there's a smoke bomb going off.
We saw four guys carrying another guy who was bleeding, and they looked pretty exhausted because they had carried him all the way out. And so they were yelling at us, so we ran over and helped take over and carried him to an ambulance.
And tonight there will be several memorials held for the victims of that shooting. KCRA3's Emily Maha is live in Thousand Oaks now with more on that and how everyone's being honored tonight. Emily.
Brian, we're here tonight at Cavalry Theater in Thousand Oaks. This is right downtown. It's right in the City Hall complex area. And if you take a look behind me, this vigil is set to start at 6 o'clock tonight, but you can see people already arriving. Doors are set to open to the public at 5 o'clock. And I spoke with a young man just a little while ago, and he told me it was so important for him to come here tonight to be here with his community and show his support for the victims of last night's shooting. He's grown up in Thousand Oaks, and he says this community is strong, and in times of need, it comes together. And he says that is what he's hoping to see here tonight. And we talked with city organizers earlier today. They tell us the large theater that you're taking a look at right here has room for about 1,800 people. He says if they meet max capacity, there is an overflow room set up in the City Hall lobby. He says that is all set and ready to go if they need the extra space. And while we've been out here, we've seen several very intimate moments between people in this community, giving each other hugs, consoling each other, and expressing their grief as a community for the lives of those 12 people lost last night. And like I mentioned, this vigil is set to start at 6 o'clock. Doors will open to the public at 5. We are waiting to be let in, and once we get in there, we'll be sure to bring you more. Reporting live in Thousand Oaks, Emily Maha, KCRA 3 News.
All right, Emily, thank you for the live report. And help for the victims is headed to Southern California right now from the Sacramento area. Vitalant, is formerly known as Blood Source, has sent blood to their sister site in Ventura County. That support was only possible because people in our area had already given blood.
That blood takes about 24 to 36 hours to be collected and processed and tested and then available at hospitals. So you can see the window of time that's needed for blood to be ready.
Vitalant says they need people in the Sacramento area to schedule appointments to give blood so that they can replenish what was sent to Ventura County so it's available when it's needed.
That's great that people here have been able to at least help in that way. We're going to take you back to Southern California for more coverage coming up at 5. Of course, Lester Holt of Nightly News will have dramatic stories of some of the survivors coming up at 5:30 on the NBC Nightly News.
We also continue to follow breaking news, this wildfire burning in Butte County. These are live pictures from Live Copter 3 just north of Magalia right now. And you can see those flames just tearing through the hillside. We know people have been injured. Two firefighters have been injured. Homes have been destroyed and thousands have been evacuated.
U.S. Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg in the hospital tonight. The 85-year-old justice broke three of her ribs during a fall last night in her office. The justice was admitted to a hospital for treatment and observation. Meantime, the U.S. Supreme Court held a ceremony today for its newest justice, Brett Kavanaugh. President Trump was there. This is considered really a sort of a ceremonial passing of the torch for a high office. And with Attorney General Jeff Sessions now being forced out by President Trump, there is a new man overseeing the Justice Department and the Russia investigation. As Blaine Alexander tells us, it's raising some questions about what this could all mean for the future of Special Counsel Robert Mueller's investigation into the 2016 election.
I was a federal prosecutor.
He has been a vocal critic of Special Counsel Robert Mueller's Russia investigation. Now, Matthew Whitaker is in charge of overseeing it, appointed acting attorney general after Jeff Sessions resigned at the president's request.
I'm disappointed in the attorney general.
Sessions fell out of favor with President Trump after recusing himself from the Russia investigation.
It is not a coincidence that this man, Whitaker, was picked.
Until yesterday, Whitaker was Sessions' chief of staff, but before that, he was a conservative commentator on cable news, where he suggested this strategy to limit Mueller's investigation.
That attorney general doesn't fire Bob Mueller, but he just reduces his budget so low that his investigation grinds to almost a halt.
Now, from Capitol Hill, calls from both parties to protect Mueller, and some Democrats going a step further.
Demand the recusal of Mr. Whitaker, who has demonstrated a pretty clear conflict of interest.
But the White House pushing back.
You're asking me if he's recused from it. Why would he? Why would he be recused?
Now, questions over who will lead the Justice Department permanently, the president promising a new appointment at a later date. And two sources tell NBC News former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie is among those under consideration for the job. Now, no matter the pick, the president's choice could have an easier road to confirmation now that Senate Republicans have increased their majority by three seats.
In Washington, Blaine Alexander, KCRA 3 News.
The captain of a duck boat that capsized in Missouri is now facing federal charges in that deadly accident. 51-year-old Kenneth McKee was at the helm when that boat went down in a Branson lake in July during a severe thunderstorm. 17 people died. 9 of them were members of the same family. Prosecutors say McKee should have properly assessed the weather before taking that boat out onto the water.
Failed to raise the side curtains, failed to instruct his passengers to don their personal flotation devices, and failed to prepare to abandon ship after each of 2 separate soundings of the vehicle's bilge alarms.
Keyes facing 17 counts, including misconduct and negligence or inattention causing death. If convicted, he could face up to 10 years in prison for each count.
Still ahead, we're going to continue to follow the big wildfire in Butte County.
Be sure to stay with us as Live Copter 3 continues to fly around the fire lines and just gives you an idea of, look at how big this fast-moving wildfire is that has already forced the evacuation of thousands and also injured several people. We continue to follow breaking news out of Butte County and this fast-moving wildfire that Live Copter 3 is over right now. And you can see the clear line of these flames just burning through this rugged terrain. We know that homes have been lost, people have been injured, including 2 firefighters.
We just got a CAL FIRE fire chief says several hundred structures destroyed in Paradise from the fire. So when you see pictures like that, that's not terribly surprising to hear. Let's check in with Chief Meteorologist Mark Fina now.
And so let's tell you what we are showing you right here. So the pictures of the live copter can show us now, we're on the north side of the fire. So this is the north flank. This is north of Magalia. This is generally wooded terrain, not too many homes in here. Now to the south of this is Magalia and Paradise. We'd like to get in there because I'm sure a lot of you are either watching from an evacuation shelter or maybe you have friends or family that have been evacuated. You want to find out what's going on in Paradise, in Magalia, in Paradise Pines. We just can't get in there yet. So as soon as we can get in there, whether it's with live copter or reporters on the field, we'll get you that information. But for now, all we can do is show you this one flank, but it is burning to the north, it is burning to the south, and it is burning farther to the west as well. Temperature-wise, we have 71 in Sacramento, 73 in Stockton, 70 in Modesto, and 42 degrees currently in South Lake Tahoe. We still have some of that wind out there. However, in Butte County, we actually saw the strongest winds early this morning, but there is still enough wind now, and enough wind will carry through the next few hours to make that fire still quite active around Paradise and toward Chico. Once you go to the south, we still have an 18-mile-an-hour wind in Sacramento, but that'll be diminishing as we go through the night tonight. We have clear skies throughout the area, as you can see. Then one thing that you can even pick out very slightly here on the infrared view is that smoke plume. When that starts to show up, you know it's a pretty big fire. But we're going to stay with clear skies through the night tonight and during the day tomorrow. And clear skies at night, that means it's going to be a pretty cool night. Temperatures in the valley will start off in the 40s. By 9 o'clock, it'll be around 59, and then through the afternoon, we'll get into the 70s. Tomorrow, we'll have sunshine, we'll have light winds. It should be a much better situation in Butte County tomorrow as well. So I think we may have to wait until tomorrow to get a full assessment of what's going on in the Paradise area right now. In the foothills, tomorrow is going to be a bright sunny day and it's going to be a cold morning. Many foothill spots might even start off in the 30s by the afternoon around 70. Sunshine, lighter winds tomorrow, even in areas like Nevada County and Placer County that had some gusty winds earlier today. And in the high Sierra, here too, we'll have a cold morning, but by noontime, Tahoe and Truckee will be into the mid-50s and by the afternoon into the upper 50s with clear skies throughout the day. 7-day forecast for the Sierra stays dry. There's your weekend around Tahoe and Truckee, getting into the mid to upper 50s with mornings down around 20. Dry weather into next week. A few clouds on Tuesday from a passing weather system that doesn't have a chance of bringing us any rain or snow. And for the valley, the temperatures tomorrow into the 70s, still well above the average of 67 degrees. We may see some cooling into the weekend, and by Tuesday, a high of 67 under partly cloudy skies and dry weather all the way through at least the middle and, well, probably the end of next week as well. Back to you.
Okay, Mark, thanks. And still to come, if you drive a Subaru, you're going to want to stick around for the next story.
Hundreds of thousands of vehicles recalled, the problem that could cause them to stall and potentially crash. Two Subaru recalls to tell you about that could cause vehicles to stall. The first affects 229,000 Outback and Legacy model year 2018. A software problem can keep the low fuel warning light from coming on and make the miles to empty display inaccurate. You can understand why that would be a problem, and that could cause the cars to run out of gas, stall, and possibly crash. The other recall involves engine valve springs that could fracture. It impacts 166,000 vehicles. The 2012 to 2014 Impreza, 2013 BRZ XV Crosstrek, and Toyota Scion FRS.
Thank you for being here with us on the KCRA 3 News at 4. Edie Lambert and Gulson Dart here now with the updates at 5.
Well, obviously, guys, a lot still going on this afternoon. We have crews spread across the state for you today in Southern California covering that mass shooting at a nightclub.
We also have reporters in Northern California tracking that dangerous wildfire.